Hey, Bryce, I saw something really cool on YouTube the other day where they actually recreated an Ariana Grande song using Labo instruments. I think we should try something like that.
Drew, your Labo kit's been sitting on the floor of the office for weeks. We were supposed to unpack it and talk about it. We never did that. How do you suppose we're going to make music for the start of the episode when it's not even made?
Good point. Maybe we can just tap the box.
All right. Okay.
Do 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 do. Dude.
Nice. Very nice.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to the House of Mario, episode 41. I'm your host, Drew Agnew, and joining me, as always, is my best friend, Bryce DeWitt.
Yes, and I'm seated next to this this beautiful, what would you call it?
Man.
I was thinking more along the lines of, like...
Pegasus?
You go to a horse race, and you get somebody yelling out there, all the action that's happening. I can't remember what you call them.
Because
that's exactly what you sounded like.
Oh. Okay, today on the show, we're going to be talking about what we've been playing. We're going to discuss the recent Pokémon and Star Fox leaks and how that will hopefully blend into E3 this year. But first, Bryce, you want to give a shout out to our Discord community?
I absolutely do. While it's, you know, only a few people just cracking out the posts in the Discord community, I'd like to thank you guys because it's a daily thing now, getting on and checking.
It has been this week. It's sort of blown up thanks to all the Pokemon hype and E3 hype going on.
And the discussion is good too. Like, it's a whole lot of fun. Whether it down to speculation or discussion on, I mean, a lot of the week we've been discussing last episode with the leaks and stuff like that, and how, you know, leaks integrate into actual news and whether it's worth paying attention to them, stuff like that. It's been really good.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to give a shout out to those few people who have been there just supporting us with bombardments of comments that we can react to, talk to, and, you know, create discussion. It's a whole lot of fun.
Mm. It's pretty cool how some... I just read today, actually, that some of them were from Aussie Nintendo back in the day.
Yes.
Small Australian Nintendo community we were a part of when... I was a kid. We were kids.
We were children. Yeah. We were like, what, 9, 10?
Yeah. So shout out to that website. Aussie Nintendo back in the day.
Yeah, it was a long time ago now. Jesus.
Mm. Oh. So, Bryce, you've put what have we been playing? Because you've been playing some games you want to talk about.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Yes. Namely, I wanted to talk about one this week that I've been playing. I think it's only been a couple days, of course. But if you haven't got a release track record of what's coming out this year so far, I've been playing Hyrule Warriors. What have you been playing?
I haven't been playing too much. I've just been sort of chipping away at Pokemon Ultra Moon. I want to finish that because I feel like I should, because I'm a big Pokemon fan. And I also want to get to the end where I can shiny hunt in the wormholes.
Yep.
Yeah, so that's what I've been doing. I haven't been playing too much of anything. Hopefully... I'm hoping to pick up the Switch a bit more this week, but yeah, haven't been playing too much, unfortunately.
Well, me and the Switch have had a love relationship for the past 2 days. I've been playing a ton of Hyrule Warriors. I have to give him commendment with all the HD re-releases of Wii U games and stuff like that coming out. When they say definitive, it is absolutely definitive. There's so much content in that game already, and I haven't been able to put it down without feeling like I'm getting bored yet, which is fantastic.
Because you didn't get the season pass or anything like that, did you?
No, sorry. I had planned to, but then, you know, time went on. I put the game down and I didn't pick it back up because DLCs releasing slowly is kind of like a hindrance for me now. I'd prefer to just play it all in one bang.
Yeah, I agree.
This has been, like, it's been an absolute joy because it's not only got DLC content from the Wii U version and the 3DS version. It's also got a couple little things scattered in there that are, you know, revamped from the 3DS version or the Wii U version. complete like remade systems, or they've got their own little additional content to it, or just minor adjustments, improvements, and stuff like that.
Okay.
And overall, and it's the same thing I've been saying since I picked it up. I'm just like, I could have paid $60 in worth of DLC, or I could have bought, and I could have bought the 3DS version, or I could have bought the Definitive Edition. And the Definitive Edition has been way more worth my time. Absolutely, 100%. I'm so glad that they actually made it a thing, because there's so much content to be loved in there that I think just got way too separated from the two versions. So
yeah. Isn't that one of those games that definitely needed to be brought over from the Wii U, especially since a lot of people seem to enjoy Fire Emblem Warriors, and Zelda being what it is, you know, people need to have played that.
Well,
if you're into that type of thing.
No, I'm not sure how much I've talked about Hyrule Warriors before, but in my opinion, it's one of the most stellar examples of Warriors game that's been released. And that's because it translates so well with the Zelda formula. They integrate the two games and meld them together into a very nice package. And in my opinion, they've just done a stellar job with it. I'm glad they re-released it, because in Japan, they've already reintroduced Warriors Orochi, and I think it was Dynasty Warriors 8 to the Switch. We haven't got them yet in English-speaking countries, but you know, it's good that they didn't forget that gem was there, because honestly, it is a good game. And if you haven't played it, it's probably the best time to pick it up now, which is awesome.
Mm. Yeah, just going back to the other Warriors games, how does it compare to other games in like just the normal Warrior series?
Well, it's hard to speak about Warriors in that respective, because it's Warriors is kind of all over the place. It almost always has three releases. The newest release, like three releases per game, and that's usually the Standard, Extreme Legends, and Empires.
Right.
Empires is the game you want to play, because you can have custom campaigns and stuff like that, and Empires is fun. If you're only looking for like a run-through story type of thing, you play, you know, the first one. If you're looking for more content, you go to Extreme Legends. And then if you're looking for the Definitive, you go to Empires.
And that's like pretty much the extreme version with like, you'll pay $150 for like that type of thing?
No, they literally come out like in sequential after each other at some point. It's like every 4 months they'll release a new version of the game.
So, like somewhat to what Street Fighter does.
Sort of, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Pretty much. It's kind of bullshit in some ways, I guess. Yeah. But you're better off just waiting for Empires most of the time.
Yeah, sounds like it.
Dynasty Warriors seems to be taking a fall from grace at the moment. They tried to do something new with their formula and make like a big open world. With their newest game in Dynasty Warriors 9, and so far it hasn't gone too well.
Okay, because I was joking to you about they should have included Hyrule from Breath of the Wild as a map.
You actually did. And then I've just remembered just now that they actually tried to do something like that with just Dynasty Warriors assets, and it didn't translate too well because apparently, as far as I haven't played, because it looked interesting, the concept, but apparently the world's just really empty. It's like the most emptiest open world you've ever seen in your life. Mm. So that's unfortunate.
You can sort of picture that too, because apart from just from what I've been watching you play, like it's really detailed, but apart from the enemies in your armies, there isn't really anything to do.
How so?
I don't know. I haven't played it that much, but just from what I can observe.
There's things to do. You've got to be playing the game to understand what your objectives are, I think.
Okay.
Like, for example, minor spoiler alert if you haven't played it, but I suppose if you played Skyward Sword, you'd probably know anyway, but what's his name?
Girahim?
No. Big black thing.
Oh, the
from the sealed grounds, you know, he walks up the mountain, you got to attack his toes and stuff like that, you know. There's stuff like that in there where it's like compulsory objectives sort of thing, and then he'll jump up in the sky, you'll go and launch a Grucinator bomb or something like that. There's little things littered like that through the levels. And you get your general items like you do in Zelda, like bombs, boomerang, arrows, hookshots, stuff like that. They all have their own unique actions with enemies and objectives and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And just, you know, it's a little more detailed than a Warriors game, I think, in that respective, which makes it great. Because Warriors is basically, you know, you control an enemy camp, you know, you're going to make sure that camp stays alive sort of thing. You're still doing that, but you add in like more boss fights and stuff like that in Hyrule Warriors, and then there's objective-based things regarding around the map. I just feel like it's one of the cleaner games because it adds that little bit more to do.
Yeah, okay, okay. All right, I'll take it back. I'm sorry.
It's one of those games that, like, in at first glance, in the first, like, hour, you kind of just, like, what's the appeal? But as you go further in, you know, like, you look at all the other content and stuff like that, it's good. Challenge maps are great, and I think there's, like, 10 to 12 of them in the Definitive Edition. And the challenge maps are basically, like, you progress along squares and stuff like that to fill out an entire map, you know?
Yeah, that's cool.
You get objectives and stuff like that to do. You get items that you pick up along the map, ways that you can use on the old Zelda map. And if you remember from the Zelda maps where the secrets are and stuff like that, you can use items to reveal those secrets, which will get you additional rewards and stuff like that. So there's actually some Zelda-based sort of trivia knowledge just from memory if you've played those type of things.
See, yeah, that is really cool.
That'll get you little things. It's just, there's a lot to love in the game, but it does require a bit of patience because there is a lot of content to it.
Like, back when I bought it on Wii U when it came out, I guess I sort of played it for a bit and I think I got bored of it. Yeah. But I do feel like I do sort of want to pick it up again on Switch and play it. But, I don't know, maybe not just yet, just with the price being a... release price at the moment, but I would like to get in there and play it.
Yeah, when you invest more time into it, you get more attached to it. I think it's a lot harder to get attached to a Dynasty Warriors game than it is Hyrule Warriors.
Yeah, look, I love the aesthetic and the music and everything they're doing. Need to get used to that gameplay and start enjoying it.
The gameplay's a little bit different, and depending on how you use certain items and stuff like that, it changes. But it's the same with the Zelda game. As your repertoire grows with items and characters, you get a better feel of the game.
Yeah. You sort of mix stuff up a bit more.
Absolutely. Anyway.
So, that was all you want to talk about that?
Well, yeah. I just wanted to say, I guess, that if you've ever been interested in Hyrule Warriors, Definitive Edition is worth the pickup. I think I picked it up for $69.
Nice.
It was worth the money. It's been worth the money so far. I think I've already dumped 20 hours into the game.
20 hours? Fucking hell. When did you pick it up? 2 days ago.
Yesterday.
Fuck it. What?
I picked it up yesterday.
Where do you find the time?
I didn't get put on work yesterday, as you know.
So you played 20 hours?
Yes, I played 20 hours of Hyrule Warriors.
What? So the only time you've taken off the game is to come here and do the podcast?
When did I pick it up? Like afternoon yesterday. I think I got home at 1 o'clock and started playing it, and it's now 9. So I've been off the game 12 hours, enough to sleep.
Oh, you're a legend.
I love the game. What can I say? It's a good game.
No, that's cool. I wish you.
Wish you had the drive.
No, I don't know if that was. I don't know if I wish out or not.
When you get engrossed in a game, it's good.
Yeah, no, for sure. That's what it's all about, the immersion.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
All right, Bryce, let's move on to the Pokemon League. So let me start again. This came out earlier last week, so it's about 5 days old at the time of recording. But regardless, I am super excited because this is pretty much what I want. If true, which there are a lot of signs pointing to yes. So we'll just go through. We'll go through quickly because we assume you guys have already seen what's going on. But if you haven't,
we did actually talk about it briefly too. But it was older news of this news.
Yeah, it wasn't as detailed.
Yeah.
So the games have been added as Pokemon Let's Go Pikachu and Let's Go Eevee remakes of Pokemon Yellow. And first off, remakes of Pokemon Yellow. Does that excite you?
Well, it's more of a sequel.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean? It excites me. It excites me because the way that the new leaks have described it. It's funny talking about leaks in a positive light because we were just shitting all over it last week. But the thing is like the news is so much more solid now that then there's a lot of physical evidence behind it that actually puts light to it. But it does, I think. I think that going back to Kanto was never a bad thing. I think like returning to Pokemon's roots is generally a good thing. Whether it's a good thing for the fan base or whether it's a good thing for returning players is a different story. But I don't think anybody hates Kanto as a region. And I think now that we have more of a fleshed out Pokedex and stuff like that, there's more.
It's like a previous episode, I've said that I hope it's Red and Blue too, and you go back to the Kanto region, whatever. But I think this is actually cooler because
it's more like Yellow too.
Well, you don't just get your, you know, fire, water, grass starter like Charmander and all that, and like it'll be different, even more different than that. So I quite like that. So we'll go through these dot points just from what's been leaked. So Pokemon remakes for Switch, two versions, Pikachu and Eevee. Red and Blue play a role in the story. You and your rival are
new trainers.
Looks like now trainers, the Texas
Aces. It does.
Following Pokemon Return, HMs are replaced with Pokeride from Alola. Online has a hub for players. Pokemon Go integration. Catching Pokemon works like in Go. Rewards in-game and in Go for linking the two together. New accessory can be used in both Go and the games. Announcement soon, releasing this year.
So, if it comes to mind, because we actually talked about this in the Discord this week.
The Discord.
There was literally a picture that came out around April Fool's Day, and that's what everybody like passed it off.
April Fool's.
It was April 1st. It was dead on April Fool's, where there was like a Eevee riding on a trainer's head and the trainer riding on the Lapras in what looks near Cinnabar.
Yeah, it looks like. It looks like it does. Between Cinnabar and Pallet Town.
It does. Yeah. It absolutely does. So the thing is this could also be very viable now.
So whoever took this screenshot, just take the extra time and let your iPhone focus, please.
I would dare say that they wouldn't have much of an opportunity. It'd be somebody visiting the company, and it's very, very hush-hush on cameras.
It's like under their jumper or something.
Yeah. Do you know what I mean? That's how most of these things come about. Now, the thing is this image could have been faked. Like, I think that's...
Very easily faked,
that can be obvious, you know, but at the same time, you know, with the corresponding leaks that have come out, it actually makes a lot of sense. Now, the reason I'm a little more confident in the leak this time is that they had website domains registered and popped up for Pokemon Let's Go Pikachu and Pokemon Let's Go Eevee. Now, this could have also been faked, but I think it's less likely to happen. Somebody registered domain names, but it's...
Well, it's the same company they used as well to register domain names for other games and systems under Nintendo too, so...
Yeah, exactly. So,
unless Nintendo is trolling us, which they could be, who knows?
Well, I think... Well, the leaks... Let's just discuss this briefly. The leaks before this were mentioning that Pokemon Pikachu... Let's Go Pikachu and Let's Go Eevee were supposed to be companion apps to the new Pokemon game. I think so. That was what the leaks said before. They... Again, with Emily Rogers talking, she's like, oh, I didn't specify whether it was Gen 8 or, you know, whatever. Continue, blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm. Go back to our skit last week, yes.
Yes. She's like, oh, I didn't say whether it's this or that. So basically she's seen this leak thing that's come out for everyone. Like, everybody's seen it at this point. She's obviously seen it before anybody else has, and it's gone, oh, they're companion apps. But no, actually, by the looks of it, that's what these games actually are, and that's what they're titled. So we're removing away from the colors and the stones and the earthly elements.
Yes, and the planets.
You know, and we're coming into sort of a more stylized direction, and a lot of people think it's like tying in with the new movie that's supposed to be coming out. There's like a new Pokemon movie that's titled something to do with Pikachu or something like that. They think like Pokemon might be pushing towards a new direction for this type of thing. I don't know, but either the case, if you haven't seen the screenshot, we'll just quickly describing to you. It's, like I said before, Eevee riding a trainer, riding a Lapras. There's a Magikarp swimming around there. There's a Gyarados tail in the back that you can see. There's the island where there's actually usually a trainer sitting with a Magikarp, if you remember in the previous games, between Cinnabar Island and Pallet Town, because that block of land for some reason is completely ingrained in my memory.
No, it is too.
It is. Wow. It is. I have a good eye, my friend.
I mean, it could easily just be like I don't remember this from Sun and Moon, at least this area. So,
Well, yeah, but you know.
So, do you think the Pokemon Let's Go? Do you reckon that relates to their sort of integration with Pokemon Go? Do you think this is going to be a pretty major thing they're going to be pushing, that Pokemon Go and the new Switch games are going to be very closely linked together?
No, I don't think it's got anything to do with it. I think it's just naming conventions for like they can't just say a lot of, like, you would have seen like a lot of like fake like Pokemon game boxes in the past and stuff like that, that it's just like Pokemon Jirachi version or I think it's in the same mind thinking as that, but they're just like, it sounds stupid if we just say Pikachu version or Eevee version, so let's give it a subtitle.
Yeah, okay. Yep.
Do you know what I'm saying? I think if there is Pokemon Go integration, which I think we cursed last week, we're like, no, why? You know, not really that interested. If there is some kind of Pokemon Go integration, I hope it's not too damaging. They reckon that you throw Pokeballs like the PokeGo style. Hmm. I'd be fine with that.
I'm of the mindset, I quite like it to be a modern PokeWalker, because back when the PokeWalker came out with Heart Gold, Soul Silver, I really enjoyed that. I was actually on a holiday at the time in Tasmania, so I was walking about everywhere, so I got lots of use out of that PokeWalker.
Yeah.
And I'd be quite happy to do that now, too. Just have it, you know, send a Pokemon to Pokemon Go, get some whatever you're getting when you're walking with it and bring it back.
Mm-hmm.
But the idea of, if it's just like a bit of a mini game to sort of make kids feel more immersed, or try and make you feel more immersed that you're actually throwing the Pokeball, that's fine. Hopefully there is an option to be like, oh, you want to toggle it on or off. But if it does worry me having how they handle the capture mechanics, because I don't want to be doing spin balls and all that type of thing you're doing in Pokemon Go.
I like doing that, though.
Do you?
No.
I'm fine with that in Pokemon Go, but I don't want that in the Pokemon game.
I think it would be a perfectly fine idea if you get a flat rate, if you're just tossing the Pokeball, like as per normal, as you would with a button, or you get a bonus for doing the actual motions. I'm fine with that. You keep the base rates the same as they are now, and then you add in that little bonus for people
to
use the touch
control.
Would
you do it so you can just miss it?
Well, yeah. Like, yeah, sure, why not? It's a risk, chance, reward thing. Like, just imagine it in that perspective. I don't want Pokemon jumping all over the screen like they do in Go, or dodging whatever, like dodging Pokeballs by yelling at them.
Pokemon Dodgeball Edition.
It's literally a scam, guys. They dodge the Pokeball, you miss the Pokeball, you lose more Pokeballs, and then eventually you're like, oh, I don't have the time to hit Pokestops this week, so you get to buy Pokeballs. Mm. It's a scam. It is the biggest scam ever.
It's not
the worst.
A scam. It's just a free-to-play game where they try to make you spend money.
You throw a Pokeball and it misses and you lose that Pokeball forever. Can't you just walk over there with your lazy ass and pick it up?
I used to tap it all the time when I miss. I thought that picked it up.
It doesn't.
Yeah, I know it doesn't. But when it first came out, I'm like, oh, I can tap it, pick it back up. No.
And no, it doesn't work that way. They just want you to buy more. it's silly. Anyway, I for the risk reward, like, you lose the Pokeball if you toss it, fine, that's all good. But if you hit a good shot, then hey, you get a bonus. I think that's fine.
Yeah, that could be okay. It just have to. I'm just gonna stay open minded until I see it in action. Like, you know, just it is kind of when you see that like a mobile game's gonna infect like a major RPG, is kind of like, ooh, I don't know, but hopefully it turns out okay.
Look, I hope that I have high hopes that the game is going to be good on its own, but I just hope that PokeGo isn't a major part of it,
like a huge influence.
Well,
like there are like positive aspects you could pull from Pokemon Go. Like, you could do like some online mode where you're trying to hold a gym with your friends and like things like that. They could really integrate like some cool things from what Pokemon Go spawned within the last 2 years. But yeah, it'd just be interesting to see.
I don't know. I fell out of PokeGo after they made a bunch of changes to the game from its initial launch.
Yeah.
I thought the game was pretty alright in its initial launch, apart from some server crashes and stuff like that, and just the general things. But then they made some changes which just made the game a little less bearable. And I know they've improved on it since then, and hell, I open it every now and then, but not enough to not enough to care.
Yeah, I would like to play it more now, but like I want to sort of use it as an excuse to get out running and that.
Yeah,
I think that'd be good. And like they're doing cool things, like they almost got like an achievement system where you're trying to do certain tasks, and then that can lead you towards a legendary Pokemon for, you know, that month or time or whatever they've got going at the time. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah. Look, I'm not disputing it. I think like if it's anything, it is a motivator to get out and do some more exercise or something like that, or go outside and do more stuff in general. So that's fine. But yeah. Anyway, there was actually other physical evidence that could be leading to this.
Yeah. So so Mr. Masuda, who's the director over at Game Freak, he's been like really leaning into these leaks. He's been posting of like plushies of Pikachu and Eevee. There's the design team who are, well, the staff at Game Freak who are all there, like with all their Eevee and Pikachu stuff out, like they're
yeah.
So I don't know if
people dressing up in big Eevee costume.
Yeah. Oh yeah, Eevee just walking around Game Freak. Did you see yeah. that? Yeah. So like not. Even if this was wrong, if I was the director or whatever, I'd be like, ah, fuck it. Let's lean into it. Let's really troll these kids.
Yeah, let's spin them around and make them look like fools. But no, it does. Yeah, it, like this is why I think that evidence there was the main reason I've been so, you know, accepting of the leaks that have come out in the past 5 days.
Yeah.
Because there's actual physical evidence to it now. It's not just, hey, here's a really crappy picture of a game and a logo that looked like it could have been designed in Photoshop and had a filter put over it within like 4 hours.
Yeah, well, even if it's a really good logo, it can still be easily faked too. Like, you can't...
Yeah. And the website domain names, again, like, even if they're registered by the same provider... You know, you never know who's on that end making shit up and putting it out there. But like with Masuda going around with the company, taking all these pictures of Eevee and Pikachu stuff, or people dressing up in big Eevee and Pikachu costumes and stuff like that going around the studio, it's a little more solidified. This is the sort of evidence you need to go, hey, maybe this leak is actually on point.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, I'm really excited about these. It was a couple of days ago. I sort of calmed down now, but like after I heard about this and that the announcement's coming soon, I'm just like, get up in the morning, check Twitter. Has there been any Pokemon news? Like, yeah, really excited. I hope this is what's going to be shown.
Do you think it'll be before E3?
I don't know. I always, like, you know, Pokemon's always done their own thing, but this year I was going to assume they're going to play nice and go with Nintendo and sort of be announced at Direct, but who knows, really? Who knows?
If the screenshot, if anything, is viable, the screenshot basically says to me that it is up-res Sun and Moon graphics.
Yeah.
Models are more detailed to the fact that they can be displayed in 1080p, whatever, and it'll be out this year.
Yeah.
I think that's the perfect viability. It is viable and possible if that's the case. Wouldn't it taken a long to develop the region of Kanto? They've already done that a million times at this point.
No, they've got to age the houses a bit, change the roof colours because the old man had to retile it because it's been 10 years.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, see?
the interesting concept, I suppose, that would be coming out of it is we'd be getting Kanto for sure. Yeah. But what else would be coming with that game?
Oh, they can't not include Johto, I feel.
I hope that I sincerely hope they do, but at the same time in my head I'm just like, they're not gonna do it.
They kinda have to. It's right there. We know it's there. Let us go there.
I would like to see it in reverse order. I would like to go from Kanto to Johto instead of Johto to Kanto.
Yeah, that'd be really cool.
Because going to Johto and having an endgame in Johto would be really neat.
I feel like if Red and Blue are integrated into the story, like they're characters in the game, they're No, Johto is going to have... No, you'll think would play a fairly huge role in that.
Well, if gold, silver, and crystal were anything to go by, then blue is a professor and red is a loner that sits on top of a mountain. So maybe red's changed his course. I doubt blue would have changed his career path. So maybe he's the new professor.
So, oh, yes, I think he will be, actually, now that you...
Maybe Blue is the new professor. That's something I just thought of.
I'd put money on that.
I would put money on that. But I don't know how Red would be fitting into it. I suppose maybe he'd be the Lance of that game.
What, he'll still be the champion, you're thinking?
Maybe not the champion. But he'd be like... In Gold, Silver, and Crystal, Lance was sort of like a mentor who... Whenever you came across a big struggle, like back at the Lake of Rage and stuff like that.
Similar to Steven.
Even Steven. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Even Steven.
Even Jesus. Steven.
God damn it, Shia LaBeouf. Anyway... You know, he'd be the mentor type of deal, maybe. You know,
he has to talk, though. So, you reckon they're going to make him give him words? I hope they do, personally, if he's a bigger character.
I think he'll be very quiet still. I don't think he'll be like, "Hey there, little buddy. I hope you've been training your Pokemon. Here's a Beldum.
Beldum.
Here's a Beldum." Or, yeah, you know.
Can I have six so I can have a Metaross?
Just... Just smack them all together. I think it'd be more like he'd be more of the stoic hero kind of type, where like he's you almost see him as like that person that's pissed off because he hasn't had his coffee in the morning. He's just like, "Follow me."
Yeah, it's just dot dot dot. Oh, okay, follow me.
So follow me. It's like Giovanni pops up. He's like, "Ha ha ha! I'm the evil leader of Team Rocket. I'm back after a massive hiatus." It's just like. He's just like, "Do I have to fix your shit before I drink my coffee this morning? Seriously? I already dealt with you 10 years ago and I was 10 then. I'm 20 now. What do you think I'm any worse?"
Yeah, old man Red, 20 years old. That's he's an ancient in the Pokemon universe.
It's just I think there's a lot of interesting concepts they could do with that game. We'd be saying goodbye to Professor Oak if that's the case, but I think we'd still see him in some form.
Yeah, I don't think he's going to die of old age.
No,
they're going to have him like in the nursing home. Lavender City, he goes, "Oh no, you go and visit Professor Oak's grave." Oh, let's get dark.
Oh god, yeah. No, let's not go that far with poor old Professor Oak.
Really get into this Kanto fan fiction. We're just going to...
I just think like having characters like Blue show up as more prominent figures is cool.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like Blue was as we all know, Blue was a bit of a dick.
He was a dick.
He was an absolute dick. He was just like, it was no different to Silver, but the difference is like Silver actually showed a change of heart by the end of his arc in Kanto, in Gold, Silver, Crystal. He actually showed a bit of a change and he was like, "Maybe I should start respecting Pokemon more and doing the right thing." And he came into more of his thing. Whereas with Blue, we never got that really. Even in the Johto games, Blue is just kind of like, "God damn it, I have to do this crap again. I'm like, I'm a scientist now. I might be a gym leader, but I don't, you know, I'm on Cinnabar Island, like, stunning volcanoes. Get out of my way." You know, he just sort of...
In Sun and Moon, though, he humbled a bit. Like, you can tell that he...
He humbled. Yeah, but that's what I'm hoping will transition into...
He's a professor. He's like, "Smell you later."
"Smell you later, kid."
You're like, okay.
Just walks out of the office. "Here's your Pikachu. Smell you later." Bye. He did, though. He humbled in Sun and Moon, and I hope that's like... I almost hope it's like the bridge between it. Do you know what I mean? Like, him and Red show up. I know you didn't pay much attention to the battle tree or whatever, but I went there and did that. And he kind of... He was more cheery and he was kind of just like, Red was saying nothing as always. And he's just like, "Don't worry about him. He's always like that. Whatever." And then you're like, "Which one of us do you want to battle?" sort of thing.
Yeah.
I'm hoping that's like him taking a job off before he starts his like career as a professor.
He's on vacation in Alola beforehand.
I just... I remember the comics come out after Sun and Moon where like Blue's just like, "Red, we're going on a holiday," and he's like, "Get off this stupid mountain. You've been up here for years. Your mother doesn't know where you are. Come on a vacation with me to the tropics. Come on, we're going." And then he like pulls him by the ear and he walks off. I hope that's the case. Like, I kind of hope it's just like, you know, Red's kind of been doing his own thing for a while, and you know, Blue's sort of brought him back into reality a little bit, and He's come down from Mount, like Red's come down from Mount Silver, and he's not doing that standing at the top of it for 10 years. That'd be nice. It's just a lot of I think it invokes a little bit for me to hear those two are back in the sense that Gold and Silver were the last you ever really canonically hear of them until Sun and Moon.
I really do hope these are more sequel-esque rather than just the remake, though, because all this sounds so good. I cannot wait for it, honestly.
Yeah, it does.
Quickly before we move on, just with the graphics very similar looking to Sun and Moon by the looks of it, how do you feel about that?
I'm fine with it.
I am too, yeah.
Transitioning into a new console is not an easy thing, and I realized that they probably already had something in the works.
Mm.
They always have something in the works, the Pokemon Company. They're never stopping. Yeah. There's always a Pokemon spin-off or a remake or a mainline game being developed. I think that these were the next step for the 3DS.
Yeah. Because these games are already... Sun and Moon are already really pushing the 3DS to the point where it doesn't let you turn on 3D at all.
Yeah.
And a new 3DS runs it much better.
Yeah.
Well.
Yeah.
So I think it'll look really good on Switch. I have no worries about that.
No, I have no problem with up-res Sun and Moon. That's fine. I don't think the majority of Pokemon is the overworld exploring anyway. And I know there are a lot of people that are just like, wow, I want Pokemon, but it's Breath of the Wild sort of deal, where it's like I'm running through these big open areas with no loading zones and there's just Pokemon gushing out the trees, but something like that takes...
gushing out the trees. That's the way to put it, yeah.
You know what I mean.
All the Ambipoms just gushing in the trees.
I understand that something like that takes a long time to develop, and you look at Breath of the Wild and you realize that, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, the time we waited for that game.
The time we waited for it, and it was worth it. It was worth it. I absolutely love the game. But anyway, there is a lot there to consider that they'd already been working on something, because again, they're always working on something. And if this is their first venture into the Switch, that's fine.
Yeah, like
I'm not going to curse it.
A while back, we said, "Well, we don't want Pokemon this year because we want them to take their time. We want." A good game we can absolutely stand by, absolutely love.
Yeah.
But if this is their first game, and apparently it's not going to be Gen 8, so
no, yeah.
No new Pokemon, no new mechanics, no
yeah,
no readjusting of Pokemon stats or anything like that. So mm-hmm. pretty much what we've got with Sun and Moon, having that on the Switch, it'll look fine, it'll look great even.
Mm-hmm.
Then the next step, that's when, you know, we want to see some differences.
Look, I was under the presumption that they said when they were developing an all-new mainline Pokemon game for the Switch, my presumption was they were starting from scratch. I don't think they... I think it's obvious now they haven't started from scratch. They already had something in the works.
Yeah.
And that's fine if they're putting it to Switch and going, let's see what we can do with the Switch first before we move on. That's okay.
So if they can get it out this year, they've got the old engine, the old whatever, up-res'd, obviously retooled for the Switch, one screen and everything.
Yeah.
No new Pokemon, So, you know, that a team as big as Game Freak, they should be able to
get
it out this year.
I can deal with that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Johto, please.
Yeah. Even just...
I'm sorry, I want it. I want it.
Yeah, I want it so bad too.
If you want to do something like that, I think it'd be good to knock two birds with one stone and show us everything you've got. You know, if they have been working on this for a while, then they've already got all the maps for everything. It's not like Kanto's the only one they're gonna...
I do want new areas and stuff though, if they can.
I don't care about new areas if they give us a second region. And there's a lot to love in Johto.
Yeah.
You know? That would look really good in those that graphic style. It'd feel almost a little bit of a waste of effort if they didn't put Johto in.
No. I want Johto so bad. Just give us all of it.
I think when you're competing in a... Well, technically, they're not competing with anything because Pokemon is in its own nature, but like... When you hold up, if it's only Kanto and you hold that game up to Zelda or something, and you're just like, these are the same price. What am I paying for?
Mm.
You know what I mean?
Well, that's just because Zelda's so...
Yeah, but like, so good. You pay $80 for Zelda. We're paying what, anywhere from $60 to $70 for a Pokemon game now. If you're going to charge $80 for a Pokemon game, I feel it needs to have that content to back it up.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I guess they're charging console prices now too.
They have to. So yeah. So please, you know, I would love Johto in there.
If our $60 Australian did not was not enough for you to include more post game, more extra areas, hopefully more $100 is Game Freak.
I remember you mentioning something like, you said that, like, I think it was Masuda said, like, it doesn't keep people's attention nowadays.
Yeah, in today's world where, you know, you're playing a million games, you got your phone, you got, you know, all this entertainment on YouTube, people aren't playing for as long and discovering all the content within games, which is probably true. But what about the people that
that are you know,
who is your audience that is buying all of your merchandise, all of your movies, all of your everything?
Absolutely.
The more they can keep us in their games, like, the better. Because what they want us to do, go over to the, you know, iPhone and start just playing free games, then you get none of their money.
Yeah, exactly. It doesn't matter if... there are people that go and do it. You know, there are people that go and they switch between multiple devices. I'm one of those people. But I can tell you now, if Pokemon came out with content, I'd do the content.
Yeah. Oh, I know we're meant to be wrapping this up, but I really want them to do, like... I know they're doing this in Sun and Moon, where it's like, oh... worldwide, all the players come together to try and catch a million in Pokemon and stuff like that. But I'd love to see some more elaborate things to do, like, as events that come out together.
Mm-hmm.
With, like, awards that actually make you go, okay, I've got to do this. Yeah. Something that makes you come back to, like, something like similar to what Splatoon's doing with Splatfest and that.
Yeah, yeah.
Might even be online tournaments. You know, once a month, or I don't know, whatever it might be. I really want to see.
You can win yourself a level 100 Magikarp with Fly. If you win this tournament, it's like, that's cool.
That's nice.
That's nice.
I really want to fly on that Magikarp.
It's just, yeah, I think this news has got us really excited, especially with all the hints pointing to yes now. I'm glad that the Let's Go Pikachu and Eevee being apps things was completely out of the question. I'm glad that that's actually translated into, no, that's what the title of the Pokemon game is, and I'm glad that's how it is.
Like, just with this year, if, like, presumably Pokemon is coming out this year, and we've got that and for, like, that and Smash Brothers for me in the same year, I'm like, yes.
Yeah, well, that's your year. That's your year covered.
I'm not going to leave my Switch.
No, that's your year covered for you. Yeah. Because, like, last year you had Zelda and Mario, and it's like, oh, it's such a good year. But this year, if you have Pokemon and Smash Bros, then you're like, oh, it's such a good year. If in 2019,
we're not that
far. I know, I'm losing myself. 2019, we get Metroid and Bayonetta. Oh, what a year. You know, there's two major game releases and then, like, stuff in the middle.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Like the nice creamy middle, which is Kirby, Yoshi, something else.
HD ports of Wii U games.
Oh, a bit of Mario Maker.
I actually want Mario Maker.
Yeah, everyone really wants Mario Maker. Yeah,
the Switch is perfect for it. Come on, Nintendo.
Yeah.
Let's do it. Anyway, we'll wrap this up by saying, yes, this looks good if this is the case.
Gotta catch them all. Certainly do.
Let's
do it. Let's go.
Let us go in the Pokemon world. Gotta catch them all.
Yep. Along with that, this literally come out probably while we're recording last week's episode.
Yeah.
So, a leak come out that Retro Studios is developing a game called Star Fox Grand Prix.
Yes.
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 So this is going to be a racing game akin to Diddy Kong Racing.
Mixed with F-Zero.
That's what this article says. But it did come out that it wasn't really F-Zero-esque. But who knows?
Right.
That's what
maybe thematic-wise they were talking about. I don't know.
Mm.
I could see it being a thing.
Won't go into all the details here right now, but how do you feel about this?
The question, I suppose, really is this what Star Fox fans want?
I think they want something what's a good game.
Oh, boy, that's harsh anyway.
That's the truth. If you're a Star Fox fan and you're like, oh, you know, the last even decade of Star Fox has been good.
Pretty shallow.
Star Fox is a series that's really lost its way, especially since...
Since
Nintendo 64, they've had experimental... like, on the DS, they experimented with touchscreen controls. On the GameCube, they sort of... The Star Fox Adventures, they sort of shoehorned Star Fox into an original IP. Rare was originally making.
Yeah, and, Dinosaur Planet.
Yeah, Dinosaur Planet.
That's it.
So, I feel like, apart from Star Fox 64 remake on DS, or 3DS, sorry, you haven't really seen sort of something Star Fox fans are really excited for.
Well, I guess Star Fox fans weren't excited for it, but if anything was considered, I thought the Nintendo DS Star Fox was good, and I thought the GameCube one was good. Not Star Fox Adventures, the Assault.
Yeah, Assault and Command on DS.
Yep. I thought Command was nice.
It was okay. Like it
had a lot of branching stories with different characters, and
yeah, it was fine. But like, you know, whatever.
I don't know. I guess it's just one of those games you had to put time into to get the value out of it. Mm. There was a lot, in my opinion, there was a lot to love in Command, at least. Mm. Whether you were a fan of Fox, Crystal, Peppy, you know, Slippy, Falco,
Jinx.
Anyone. You know what I mean? And then they had like a couple of original characters in there, like Slippy's wife.
Nice.
There's just, you know, there was a lot in there, I feel, that like could have been loved, but I think especially when it comes to like some of the characters that we introduced in adventures like Crystal. I don't think anybody likes Crystal. I think everybody hates Crystal.
No, I don't think most of it's probably to do with what game she first appeared in.
Yeah, 100%. I don't think Crystal is a bad character at all. I think Crystal is fine as a character. I think it's just unfortunate she appeared in the worst Star Fox.
It's not like everyone's like, oh, Peppy, what a character. What a character is Peppy. What a...
Oh, Peppy, hey, do a barrel roll. Am I right, guys?
No. But
you got an enemy on your
when
tail.
I first heard about this leak news, whatever you want to call it, it personally excited me a lot. I think Star Fox needs a reinvention.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And having it as sort of a racing game with hub worlds and things to explore in it, I think that's a really good way to do it as well.
You know, I don't mind the idea of a Junker Star Fox, which is like... you're making your own ships or something like that. Something akin to if you've ever played Star Wars Episode One Racer for the 64, mm-hmm. where it was basically like, hey, you've got like this ship and you're like, you've got this junkyard where you can like purchase and add parts to your vehicle or stuff like that to modify your vehicle to specifically the way you want it to drive.
Yeah.
Star Wars Episode One Racer was a freaking good game, by the way. It was a great Nintendo 64 game
It's the best thing that came out
for a
that
licensed
movie
game. Yeah, literally, it was really good. I think something like that would be really great for Star Fox. I think that'd be awesome. I don't think that's where the series should head. I think as a spin-off game, it would be great though. Mm. I hope that if this is...
No, I'm not saying like every Star Fox game from now on is a racing game where you're going around.
Where's Captain Falcon going to go, the poor lad? He'll be knocked out of his own race, even though he hasn't been in a race for a long time.
I really hope there's a little... when it comes out as a little box, I hope the corner... I'm so sorry, everyone. I really hope the corner of this game's box art is just added Falcon mode, new Falcon mode, like the new funky mode.
Yeah, just Falcon punch your way to victory.
That just adds just Falcon punch, Falcon punch, Falcon punch. Anybody says it the whole time.
Anybody comes to the side of your car, you just punches them, knocks them off the track.
Yeah, it's just invincibility mode or something. Yeah, so. Pretty much, it sounds like you're like, oh, so-so in the game. Like, You have to see it to really have an opinion on it.
Well, yeah. I think it's something that we need more news on before I can make a judgment.
Yeah.
But I think a Junker-style Star Fox would be cool.
Hmm. Yeah. But how do you feel about Retro working on it?
I don't know.
Especially now that we know Metroid Prime 4 is a thing, so, you know, you don't have to get your knickers in a knot that there's no brand new Metroid Prime coming out.
I don't know. I've never... Have they done anything racing that I've seen in recent years?
I mean, they worked on Mario Kart 7 on 3DS, and I guess they worked on Mario Kart 8 as well.
They worked on it?
Yeah. They did map design for the Donkey Kong level in Mario Kart 8 as well.
Map design, right. Okay.
Yeah.
Just map design.
It's one of the best courses, too.
Yeah, but just map design?
Well, I don't know what it just is. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. If it is done by Retro Studios, then I hope their first real endeavor into developing their own racing game turns out well. But a part of me is just like, as much as I can get why people hated Adventures, maybe it was just me at a younger age, but I didn't see why everybody hated it that much. Maybe it's, again, because it was not what Star Fox fans wanted, but I hope that it just doesn't turn out like that and people are just like, this is not what we want from a Star Fox game. We want an on-rail shooter. You know, I hope that's the case. Yeah, I hope they don't get the same backlash.
I feel like the people saying that are very, very small, like the amount of people saying that.
What about Star Fox Adventures?
No, but saying that they want an on-rail shooter, I just don't think that's the... In 2018, I don't think that's really, you know, that popular.
I don't know. You ask the people to play Time Crisis in the arcades, I guess. And you know,
I love those games too. Like, I really like Sin and Punishment as well. But yeah,
yeah. I don't know. It's I guess just down to my core, I just think it's not my place to be like, is this what Star Fox needs?
We'll see at E3, I think.
I loved Lilat Wars. I loved Star Fox Assault. I loved Star Fox Command, but. You know, Assault and Command, those were also games that weren't generally received well by people for whatever reason. I'm not sure why Assault had some ground sections where you played as Fox in like a third-person type shooter type deal. Maybe that's why people didn't like that.
Mm.
But I thought that was fine. And Command, I guess because it was a DS game and they wanted a Wii game.
I think it's just like the touch... Like, a lot of people didn't like the touchscreen controls and...
Yeah, I don't know. I thought it was okay. I just think... Like you said earlier, Star Fox has been lost for a while and it's a bit hard to gain traction, but I think that's more due to the fan base overthinking it, what they want. Like, a lot of people are like, the reviews come out and like, this is not what we want from a Star Fox game. And it's just like, well, maybe the series is trying to find footing outside of an on-rail, you know?
Yeah. It'd be interesting to see if it's like just racing or whether they have like a bit more stuff in there, like maybe missions type of thing.
Yeah.
Like story mission mode rather than just racing, who knows? That could be cool. I'm looking forward to it. Hopefully, regardless if this is real, hopefully we do see Retro's game. It is time this year to see Retro Studios at E3.
Yeah, we need Retro.
Yeah.
I think.
I mean, how funny would it be if all they've been working on was just the Donkey Kong Tropical Freeze port? That's what they've been working on.
Funky mode.
Was that four years? Yeah, 4 years. That's what they've been working on.
Don't forget Funky mode.
You're a singing little man today, aren't you?
I am.
All right, Bryce, we'll move into the plugs.
All right.
So on the 5th of June, we're going to be... that's when we're going to release our episode for our E3 predictions. And if you would like to join us in predicting what you think is going to be involved in Nintendo's E3 digital presentation, what are they calling it this year? Just whatever.
Oh, Digital Hikimadu.
Oh, that's a cool name.
Digital Hikimadu. Boo.
That's a cool little catchphrase too.
All right.
That's wonderful.
Hire me, Nintendo.
No, don't do that.
Please. I need money.
If Nintendo hires you, you're just going to be sitting in the microphone. They go, Nintendo, where's $200?
Do you like my sound effects, Nintendo? Doobie doop 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 doop
doop doop. Just anyway, if you would like to join in our E3 predictions episode, which will be on the 5th of June, send in your predictions to our Twitter, which is at the House of Mario, or our Discord community that is...
in the show notes.
In the show notes. See, I've got a good echo here. That's
in
good.
The show notes.
And that will be under our weekly topics section in the Discord community.
Yeah, absolutely. Send them in so we can talk about them on the show.
Also, got a P.O. box. We're not going to tell you that because that would be very a slow way of sending it in. And if you don't have the internet, how did you download this podcast? And there's a lot of questions. We'll go with that.
Yeah, they heard it on the gramophone. That's fine. We started releasing physical copies of our episodes via records.
That'd be sick. What about one of those like cup phones you like using the treehouse? You just like put up.
Yeah, we just have one networked all over the country, and people are like, get around, boys! It's time for the ASMR Mario, and they like put this single like cup phone on the bar. And they're talking.
Oh, so they're all just like listening. So why is this random dickhead just doing sound effects, and he thinks Nintendo's going to hire him?
You're fucking rude.
I am very rude. I'm a rude man. So, Bryce, where can they find you on Twitter? This is the longest plug we've
ever done. Bryce DeWitt.
You can find me at iDruby. And we're a part of the 8-Bit Collective.
We are a part of the 8-Bit Collective.
We are.
Yes, my friend.
Yes. A group of Australian podcasters all joined together to make some good podcasts.
Yes, yeah, I guess that's the best way you can put it, right?
I've just run out of steam, man.
It has been a long day for you.
Yes, it's been.
So much time kicking around balls.
Bryce, what is our Nintendo jukebox this week?
What is our Nintendo jukebox this week? I believe that something actually happened on the Jimmy Fallon show.
Friend of the show.
Yes, a friend of the show. Good to see you on here, Jimmy. We love your stuff, and you know, glad you're listening to us.
Yeah.
Anyway, on the Jimmy Fallon show, whether you've seen this or not, they've actually done a cover of an Ariana Grande song with Ariana Grande using Labo sounds.
Yeah, well, Labo instruments. So they've actually like designed their own instruments. So they've done a guitar. They've done. Ariana Grande, she's actually holding like a cardboard triangle, which is hooked up to like a remote, like a remote Joy-Con. She uses the hit and do the chimes, and they're using the fishing rod to do some of like the like sound effects and stuff. It's really cool. Mm. It's really interesting.
Yeah, yeah. I didn't know this was a thing when it was brought up to me just before we started the show. I thought it was in reference to something that Ariana Grande already did a while ago, and that was use Nintendo sound effects in a song.
Mm.
But then he's like, oh no, it's with Labo instruments. I'm like, oh, now that makes sense.
I actually really enjoy it. Like,
oh, I think it's cool too.
My girlfriend's always listening to Ariana Grande like in the car or something when she's traveling with me. I'm like, oh my God, just like, you know, just whatever. But this is actually a really cool song, and it pretty much... This Labo version of it actually sounds like a bit like a toned down sort of acoustic version of it, which
it does.
Really cool.
Yeah,
it's really nice.
Yeah.
Anyway, so have a listen. If you want to watch the full video, we'll leave a link to Jimmy Fallon's YouTube channel. It's the video is worth watching. So go and support him. Go and give him an extra 1 million views. He's already.
Come on, Jimmy.
Yeah, Jimmy.
You're gonna get that 7 million views.
7 million.
20 million.
You've 142
million.
He's got to catch
million.
Up to This Is America in YouTube views, which is like at 150 million.
Don't meme it.
Yeah, don't. People meme anything. All right, Bryce.
It's got a message. Sorry.
You're right. I'll forgive you. All right, guys. Thanks for listening. And we'll see you next week.
Yes. See you in the future.
Shut your mouth. And if you don't know, then now you know it, babe. Know it, babe. turn it up. Yeah, we turn it up. They point out the colors in you. I see them too, and boy, I like them. I like them. I like them. We way too fly to partake in all this hate. We out here vibing. We vibing. We vibing.
Coming out.
Even when it's raining now.
Can't stop now.
Tears up, so shut your mouth.
Shut your mouth. So we turning up. Yeah, we turning up.